I want to thank our witnesses today, Ms. Williams, Colonel Vindman, both of you for your service to the country, for your testimony here today. And I just want to address briefly some of the evidence you presented, as well as others thus far in the impeachment inquiry. First of all, I want to join my colleagues in thanking you, Colonel Vindman, for your military service. And I should tell you that notwithstanding all of the questions you got on why didn't you go talk to your supervisor, why didn't you go talk to Mr. Morrison, why did you go to the national security lawyer, as if there's something wrong with going to the national security lawyer, are you aware that we asked Mr. Morrison whether he went to the national security lawyer right after the call and that he did?
I am.
And are you aware also that we asked him, well, if you had this problem with Colonel Vindman not going to you instead of the lawyer, naturally you must have gone to your supervisor, and you know his answer was, he didn't go to his supervisor either. He went directly to the National Security Council lawyer. So I hope my colleagues will give him the same hard time for not following his chain of command that he complained about with you, apparently. The president may attack you, and has. Others on right-wing TV might attack you, and they have. But I thought you should know, and maybe you know already, that this is what the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff had to say about you, Colonel Vindman. He is a professional, competent, patriotic, and loyal officer. He has made an extraordinary contribution to the security of our nation in both peacetime and combat. I'm sure your dad is proud to hear that. My colleagues have tried to make the argument here today, and we've heard it before, that the president was just interested in fighting corruption. That's our goal, fighting corruption in Ukraine, this terribly corrupt country. The problem, of course, with that is there's no evidence of the president trying to fight corruption. The evidence all points in the other direction. The evidence points in the direction of the president inviting Ukraine to engage in the corrupt act of investigating a U.S. political opponent. Ambassador Yovanovitch was known as a strong fighter of corruption, so what does the president do? He recalls her from her post. Ambassador Yovanovitch, in fact, was at a meeting celebrating other anti-corruption fighters, including a woman who had acid thrown in her face on the day she was told to get on the next plane back to Washington. You prepare talking points for the president's first conversation with Zelensky. He's supposed to talk about rooting out corruption. If this president had such a deep interest in rooting out corruption in Ukraine, surely he would have brought it up on the call, but of course we now know that he did not. We then see Rudy Giuliani not fighting corruption, but asking for an investigation of the Bidens. And my colleagues say, well, maybe he was acting on his own. Even though he says he's acting as the president's lawyer, maybe he was really acting on his own. But the two investigations that Rudy Giuliani wanted come up in the meeting you participate in on July 10th at the White House, when Ambassador Sondland brings up the Bidens and Burisma in 2016, tells the Ukrainians who want that meeting in the White House, you got to do these investigations. Now, they would say Ambassador Sondland was acting on his own, but that doesn't quite work either, because we have the call record from July 25th, which the president was forced to release, in which the president doesn't bring up corruption. He doesn't say how those anti-corruption courts going or great work in the RADA. Of course not. What does the president say? I want you to investigate the Bidens and this debunked conspiracy theory pushed by Vladimir Putin. That also helps me in my reelection. So much for fighting corruption. The message to Ukraine, the real message to Ukraine, our U.S. policy message is, don't engage in political investigations. The message from the president, however, was the exact opposite. Do engage in political investigations and do it for my reelection. And it's also made clear, if they want the White House meeting and ultimately if they want $400 million in U.S. aid, this is what they have to do. The only lament I hear from my colleagues is, it wasn't successful. They got caught. They didn't get the political investigations and they still had to release the money. Now, they still haven't gotten the White House meeting, but they had to release the money because a whistleblower blew the whistle. whistleblower the president wants to punish. And because Congress announced it was doing investigations, and very soon thereafter, the president was forced to lift the hold on the aid. They argue, well, this makes it okay that it was a failed effort to bribe Ukraine, a failed effort to extort Ukraine. That doesn't make it better. It's no less odious because it was discovered and it was stopped. And we have courageous people like yourself who come forward, who report things, who do what they should do, who have a sense, as you put it, Colonel, of duty, not to the person of the president, but to the presidency and to the country. And we thank you for that. At the end of the day, I think this all comes back to something we heard from another career Foreign Service officer just last Friday in a conversation he overheard with the president in a restaurant in Ukraine, in which the president, not Rudy Giuliani, not anyone else, the president of the United States wanted to know, are they going to do the investigations? This is the day after that July 25th call. Are they going to do the investigations? And he's assured by Ambassador Sondland, they're going to do it. And what does Sondland relate to this Foreign Service officer after he hangs up that call? The president doesn't give a expletive about Ukraine. He only cares about the big things that help his personal interests. That's all you need to know. And it isn't just about Ukraine, of course. Ukraine is fighting our fight against the Russians, against their expansionism. That's our fight, too. That's our fight, too. At least we thought so on a bipartisan basis. That's our fight, too. That's why we support Ukraine with the military aid that we have. Well, the president may not care about it, but we do. We care about our defense. We care about the defense of our allies. And we darn well care about our Constitution. We are adjourned.